Blues gave birth to a baby named Rock and Roll.
Mm-hmm.
Rock and Roll gave birth to a baby named
Joe Perry. You know, we've always been a 1 in 10 like band. You know, it's always been those opposites: career, downfall with drugs; marriage, bring it back up again. But we've always been that, from one gross end to the other, and making it work somewhere in the middle.
No matter how good we think we're doing it, or anybody else thinks we're doing it, there's always a hunger there to do it a little better.
All we know is that it's an adventure, and we're doing it every day. As long as we find it exciting, we're going to get up and keep doing this. And what else would make us want to sit here and be interviewed?
Are you ready to rock?
Yeah!
I said, are you ready to rock?
Yeah!
Get it!
What is it about the blues that doesn't speak to a 14-year-old, but you get to a certain age, 25, with some people, happens a little bit later, all of a sudden it speaks to you?
If you want to look at the big picture of what blues is, there's a lot that speaks to a 14-year-old. As far as rhythm, it's not just having heartbreak, and that's one part of blues, but the other part of blues is taking you away from that and having a party and rocking out. When a lot of these blues songs were written, we're talking about guys who were in their early 20s, you know, writing and playing this stuff.
I'm not sure why I loved the old blues better later on, but I think sometimes it has to do with experiences that people go through. Young kids are going, stepping, you know, falling down, stepping up, and they haven't had enough experiences under their belt to sit back and listen to someone moan about it and really relate to it.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for most situations where you can't do all about it. You know, so you gotta either let someone sing about it and laugh.
You know, we studied the blues back when we were teenagers, but we wanted to be in a rock band. We kind of were wrapped up in making Aerosmith be its own thing.
We all met one summer in 71 and just realized we wanted to put a band together, so we all moved to Boston. We got an apartment and it started there.
I remember, you know, being in my parents' house in the garage, practicing with the band, going, wow, it would be great if we could record someday.
Can you take us back a long time ago to here at the Boston Garden, you and Joe on stage? This is before Aerosmith was who we know Aerosmith as. You were standing on the stage in empty Boston Garden. You had predicted that one day you're going to own the stage.
69, wasn't it? It actually happened twice in the career. Once was Madison Square Garden and Zeppelin played. I met Robert Plant and Jimmy, and we were invited to go backstage. So they showed up late, and I went out on stage. I laid down on the back of the stage and looked back. And I don't know why, but I just to feel the immensity of the house, that huge, yawning, calling void, to really feel it, to put it into tangible. And we did the same thing, but this time I got to do it with Joe at the Garden and look out again and feel that feeling and say, look at each other and say, hey,
maybe
someday. The idea back then is to make it big, which means being on the radio and not playing the local bars and playing where the other bands that you look up to play, you know, like the Orpheums and so forth. So it's the rush of a lifetime, you know, hearing your stuff on the radio. 1972, when we got this band together, we all, you know, one of my favorite sayings was, we just want to get our foot in the door. you know, to get into the business because we wanted to be big. We wanted to be a rock and roll band. We wanted the lifestyle.
If you don't push the envelope, you know, you don't get any further. You can always sit back on the fence and be safe and have it work time and time again. But that's not what we're about. And pushing that envelope and pushing our limits and stretching it out is what it's about. You know, you push, you find out. And if you get to a point in time where it's not going to work, you know, you'll learn that too. But so far, we haven't gotten there, so we just keep pushing along.
You know, we don't like to put an album out that everybody says is okay. If there's a little risk involved, if it's scary, if it's a song I'm not sure about, we would rather put that out, you know, than something that we're sure of. Because then you don't take any risks, you know, no gain, no loss, no, you gotta have some fun with it.
As long as we don't sell ourselves short, as long as we don't hurt anybody, as long as we keep it fun, as long as I can bounce off the guys and say, hey man, is that cool? What do you think? Would you do that? That's where it's at for us. Well, I got good news, she's a real good liar.
After being, you know, around as long as we have, we're obviously not in it for the money, or we would have stopped about 10 years ago, you know. So, I mean, we're into it for the music.
Being so high for so many years, you know.
In the 70s, you know, we were like doing it to the max.
We were snorting up everything we could get our hands on, getting as high as we could. And what happened was, is that it took away the creativity to write songs.
I remember when, you know, videos came to be. That surprised me. You know, it was the success of MTV and Much Music and this whole new thing. And luckily, we were around for that.
And have had a lot to do with the evolution, I'm thinking, too.
Yeah, there really was a day when I thought that train left the station without us. You know, during the early 80s, the band kind of broke apart. And that's when, you know, videos really came into being. And I thought, oh, man. You know, we're gonna miss that.
Joe, when Joe took off, I know he wanted to get a band together, but he wanted to be the Joe Perry Project. So that was fine for him, and so he did. There was a lot of outside influences that that created that disturbance. And, you know, he's a man of his own right. He could do what he wants to do, so he did what he wanted to do. Mm-hmm. I think he thought maybe he could do it by himself. As strong an entity as I am, I still would not want to do it by myself.
What happened that the split came between you and the band and you went off and formed the Joe Perry Project?
A lot of politics involved that I wasn't happy with, and I was frustrated. I had a lot of songs I wanted to do, and I wanted to put out a solo album of my own, and it was complications from the management. And I'd say Steven and I weren't getting along too well. We've talked about this a lot. I guess anybody who's an Aerosmith fan knows that there was a lot of trouble there, and I don't know whether it was I quit or they fired me. So,
I think it's.
Did you fire me?
Of course, we fired you. You didn't quit on us.
How does it feel to have the band back together like it was?
Incredible. It's like this time around we savor every minute of it. You know, we don't let a moment go by. You know, every little detail of playing, rehearsing, even band meetings with our manager. They're, you know, it's more fun, more interesting. We have this great band that, you know, it's just a blast to play in this band, and we're more aware of you know, just how good we have it, I guess.
With Done With Mirrors, there was a hunger that the band admits maybe wasn't there previously.
At that time, we had learned how to do everything right the wrong way. And that's still a good thing. I think that when you learn to do all the right things the wrong way and get it wrong the first time, there's something magic about that, if you can follow that.
I think there's a whole bunch of new kids that don't know Aerosmith or didn't know of them until this. Yeah, it made our popularity go zing. But the other side of that is that it didn't happen overnight. This happened like a year ago, more than that. We were in the middle of the last tour and said, come on down. We said, why not? You know, it was fun. We made it fun. I think it was as much fun doing it as you read it when you watch TV.
Right.
And one hand washed the other. It brought us back to where we wanted to be popularity-wise. There's no control. He just lets his emotions go.
I'm thinking of Run DMC, I'm thinking of the Eminem Dre sample. What is it about Aerosmith that the black experience or the urban experience, it applies as the sensibilities?
I do believe that rap and hip hop is a direct descendant of blues. I think it's like it's the modern day blues. It's elemental, it's primal, it speaks to the street, speaking to the experience in the poetics. It hangs on a good, strong lyric, and so I see a direct lineage. I mean, it's a, and so for, you know, the rock and roll thing to kind of mix along with that, it's all one.
Can I throw an old quote at you? It's an old Little Richard quote, and I love this quote.
Mm.
Full of filth, full of soul.
Full of filth?
Full of soul.
Is that Little Richard?
He's talking about Aerosmith. This is going back a few years.
Having Little Richard say that we were full of souls is an incredible compliment, and saying that we're full of filth doesn't bother me at all. No, that's true. Maybe because when you make a record or you come up with something new or you're, you know, out there doing this in front of a bunch of people, you have to reach down and, you know, maybe there's some dark parts of our personalities that give us the compulsion to do this. So, there's the filth, you know?
He was perfect.
Well, Richard, you know, definitely full of filth and full of soul.
You can have a room full of 5-year-old kindergarten kids, and you can put music on, and kids will dance around to the fast stuff, and they'll move slow and stupid to the slow stuff. And anybody can react to the music like that, but it's those that see the rest of them reacting like that and say, now I can sit down behind the drums and do-da-da-da-da-da, and make people do that and start creating like that. And I love that somebody like that would say that about us, who has injected into our very souls his type of music that was just flipped out. That's so great.
Reminds me of like the Grateful Dead saying, we were stoners.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They ought to know.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Gee.
Toxic Twins are just a name given us for being so high for so many years, you know.
Actually, I think it was Spin Magazine, in one of the random notes kind of things, they called us the Toxic Twins or something. And then right about that time, Steven and I were in rehabs or something, and my wife had some t-shirts made up, the Toxic Twins World Tour. And it just listed all the rehabs on the back, you know, various stops around the recovery land, you know. And so that's how it just started, I guess. But, you know, I guess the Toxic Twins long before anybody really called us that, because in the 70s, you know, we were like doing it to the max.
You know, in the 70s, we were snorting up everything we could get our hands on, getting as high as we could. And what happened was that it took away the creativity to write songs. Whoops. You know, it's Aerosmith is Aerosmith. And we always took great pride in writing our own stuff and being there. And if I'm going to be on stage, be there. Don't be a shadow of yourself, you know, going, you know, and falling over on the stage. It was cool for a few minutes. And, you know, it really took its toll on us. So we decided not to do that anymore. It's simple.
See, the reason people get strung out on drugs is because it makes you feel so good, you know, and
you know, there's a million people out there that are strung out on drugs because it makes them feel so good that they forget how to live. Yeah. And their life starts slipping away. Mm-hmm. And the best that we can do is just say, you know, we were there and we're here now. Yeah. You know, and even though it felt scary for the first year, a couple months, you know, to not have a little vial in my pocket,
yeah,
that there's life after meth and all that stuff. But there's a lot of people out there that smoke a little weed every once in a while, and I'm not saying that they should, but I wouldn't go out and say, don't do that, don't do this, don't do that, because no one's going to listen.
Yeah.
It's just to be an example is the best you can be.
Joe and I were riding that huge horse for the longest time, and we fell off, you know?
Yeah.
And it's no big deal. The big deal is that we're still alive to talk about it. To survive the 70s the way we're doing it is a miracle, and it's a miracle. So so we're real proud of that. We're not here to tell kids, don't do drugs, don't do this. I think I'm here for, if I can show them an example, if I can give them some you know, insight on what the hell I went through.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's like no way out. There's death, jail, and insanity.
Well, I'm not going to stand here and preach to anybody. All I can say is just figure, you know what you're doing and know what you're in for. Because there's been an awful lot of people that have been laid to waste by those chemicals.
Right.
You know, and we're back here to tell you about it.
It's the downfall. I mean, for the drugs and the booze in the beginning, it was wonderful. It allowed a tripping LSD, you know, it got me there. And the thing about those drugs is, the hell of it, is that it'll get you around the neck and then it takes you under. Like a raccoon do to a dog. Dog jumps in the water, don't ever let your dog jump in the water with a raccoon because the raccoon will drown it. It'll pull it right under. Just when it thinks it's got him by the neck, the raccoon will drown it. And that's what happens with the drugs. It steals your spirituality. If you're a painter, just gone. Can't decipher between colors. And, you know, there are so many artists that say yes, and that's why Van Gogh used all those colors, is absinthe drinking. But it worked for us for a while, and then it started taking us under.
The great lost Aerosmith weekends over a bag of a Coke or whatever, drinking too much, where I didn't remember whose house I was at or who I was stupping. You know, now in the past.
There's nothing wrong with passing the message on that, you know, that I'm a survivor. But when you really see how many people didn't make it, how many people still don't, it makes you get real humble. I'm not sure if I would be sober if he was, or the rest of the band. We were really tight in that. And that it's a miracle. I mean, it's a miracle that we're here.
Just being fortunate to live through it and be awake and not take that one last shot and have it be the end, you know, we were just fortunate, and I was fortunate that I was able to, like, have somebody to shake me and go, you know, try it this way.
If you hit your bottom like I did and you want a way out and your arms are sore and it's the summertime and you're wearing long sleeve shirts because you got tracks up and down your arms and you're feeling not so good and you're afraid of AIDS and you just had it, you're at the end of your rope, there's NA and there's recovery places to go and turn it around, and that would be the only message that I've got.
There was a time where drugs were cool.
Mm-hmm.
Latter half of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, drugs were not cool, and that was accepted, and bands like Aerosmith and a lot of other bands were denouncing it. Lately, I'm seeing in the industry, it seems to be trickling back in.
It's gonna always be there, you know? We've never been advocates to say, don't do that, even though we went public with our own addictions. It's more about, if you ever get out as far as we did, there's hope to come back. And that's the end of it. Other than that, there's nothing that'll get you more intoxicated if you let it than a good Aerosmith B-side. I'm addicted to adrenaline. That rush of going out on stage, I think in 2 minutes I'm going to be walked out a door and face 30,000, 40,000, 100,000 people. Once you get the thrill of it, I think, and you taste the blood of the rock and roll, you feel the warmth from the fire that we dance around, it's just insane. I got so out of it in the 70s that I wasn't quite sure what I was. In fact, I remember a therapist once asking me, "Who are you?" I said, "Well, I'm loved by my mom." That's something really dumb. And I went way off on this tangent. And I think that I survived all that. And I know too many people who didn't. And it was all based around that you can do it, and that the light at the end of the tunnel may be you.
Remember, the light at the end of the tunnel may be you.
And it's not an oncoming train. And the power of positive thinking, and life's a journey, not a destination, and all that stuff.
Life's a journey, not a destination.
The glass is half full and not half empty. All that's the spiritual side that I needed to fertilize. I needed to cultivate, so, you know, because that's how songs are grown.
Every time we play in that Boston Garden, which is now the Fleet Center.
Whenever I'm in that building, playing on that stage, I always look up. In 1968, I saw Hendrix in that building. And I always look up to the seat where I sat in, watching Hendrix. I always look up there, look at that group of people up there and think about that.
When Aerosmith goes out on the road, it's a whole thing. It's a religion. It's like a rock and roll type revival. It's like we go on stage, the act is as much as the music. You know, a lot of bands don't have that now.
I'm addicted to adrenaline, that rush of going out on stage, and I think in 2 minutes I'm going to be walked out a door and face 30,000, 40,000, 100,000 people.
I don't know, I sometimes get this feeling that, you know, rock and roll makes you feel so young. The good ship Aerosmith is like this craft that's going along at light speed, and every time we go on tour, we come back to Earth and we're like a couple of years younger. It's, you know, when you travel the speed of light, supposedly, when you come back to Earth, all your parents are going to be dead and you're still going to be like a year older. It's just sometimes, you know, just to be able to write these songs, put them on an album, and go out there and throw parties for like 20,000 people at a whack, it's just phenomenal. I got to scratch my head and go, is this Earth?
It's probably the most insane thing you can do is walk out on a stage in front of screaming fans like that with all the volume, but that's the place that seems slain for us, so that's what makes it not a job.
Being on stage, playing live, having that audience there responding, there's nothing quite like it.
We feed off the audience and the audience feeds off us. I think that's the pattern, and that's what happens. You know, we just kind of get out there and get in that space and let it rip.
What's different and special about Aerosmith fans is they know what they like, they want what they like, we play what we like, we know what we like, and it's just it's a meeting of, it's like any band, you have your following. With Aerosmith fans, the music is more often than not a little bit over the top, a little sideways, a little on the edge, and so are our fans. So it gives us something to go on the road for. The beauty of playing live is to be able to get to a place in your own head, you know, where you don't care if you make mistakes. It's all in the night of playing, and it should be about that, and it should be about where you're at today, and you shouldn't be afraid to, hang your dirty laundry, so to speak, because rock and roll is all about dirty, and it's all about real.
The live experience, still exciting after all this time?
Yeah, we're addicted to adrenaline, you know, and you get a direct response back from a song you wrote in the basement going, yeah, let's write a song about that. Or, you know, when it works, you bring it out and you serve it. It's the Blue Plate special. Mm-hmm. And everybody's crowding in the diner to get it, and it feels good, you know?
Well, you know, live is a real deal. It's like being able to feel the sweat off the stage and us being able to feel the sweat off the audience and pushing it to the edge. Sometimes the edge crumbles a little bit. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes you just hang right on there like the ice stays firm, but that's what's fun about it, is being able to push it and not knowing where it's going to go.
Lots of the stuff comes from him picking up a thing, and I'll hear it and I'll say, what is that? What is that? And that's where the fun of songwriting starts. That's the germ. We call them germs, you know?
And that's the one thing, you never know where it comes from.
You can sit in the basement, you turn the dad on or a tape machine, and you just jam.
how it always amazes me how we can be writing something in the basement. And like some people go down and work in their shop, you know, whatever. We go down and work with our guitars, and then 6 months later we're playing the song 4,000 miles away from home in front of people who know it. And that always blows my mind.
The lyrics. Because either I get them right off, or you got to sit down and go, let me see. And I got to put the headphones on and listen to the track. Because music being the language it is, talks to me, and I go, and sometimes I just scat, no words, and I can hear words in it. But anyway, sometimes it's a long, involved process.
Sex and, you know, angst and stuff, you know, that's usually what the theme is. Basic human emotions, you know, fear, anxiety, and sex.
So, you know, Steven's like, you know, like if you have your dog, you know, and you start howling, and if you hit a few notes, the dog just automatically, like, kind of clicks in and starts howling next to you. You know what I mean? And Steven's like that. When I start playing something, if it gets him howling, then it's like, you know, we're on the right track, and it's a natural thing.
Coming upon a guitar player like Joe that would play a line that was something unlike anything I'd ever heard on a record before, like that whole, it was the kind of thing that what works for me as far as songwriting goes, what Joe has to offer. It's something I've never heard before, so I throw a line on it that consequently is not like something else that's ever been heard, and then you have a marriage of some new stuff.
It's really good fortune that, you know, like, we found each other and it works like that, you know?
We've got some good stuff in us where the melody lines come out, and the only thing we have left to do is, once the good melody comes out, is just screw it up a little bit.
Just a bit.
Just F it up a little bit and get it just gnarly. You know what I mean? Find this good melody line and play it on a banjo with a kazoo overlapping.
Give me a prime example of screwing up.
There's something wrong with the world today. Living on the edge. Yeah, we're living on the edge.
Usually it's an explosion of some kind of emotion that just happens, and that's when you really feel that thing where you don't really have anything to do with it. Well, you're not like really in possession of all your faculties at that point, because, you know, like you're really something else out there is speaking through you. You're just like an antenna, and the shit is out there, and it just kind of comes through because you can't really take any responsibility for it. It's not like you sit there and go, well, today I will make magic. Well, that's not what happens, you know.
It has to pass through the Aerosmith filter. And it's got to be an Aerosmith song when it comes out.
But, you know, we could sit here all day and talk about what songs mean to us, but that's not it. It's what they do for someone. It's something it's in the ear of him who hears it or her who hears it. You know, it's what does it do for them? Well, how does it get them off? Does it get them off? What does it do for them? You know, is it groovacious? That's what really matters, you know. We've always been that from one gross end to the other and making it work somewhere in the middle. Aerosmith on The Simpsons? No way! Hello, St. Louis!
That's Springfield, Stephen.
Yeah, right.
Guitar album, simple, you know, get it back to the guitars. And Steven gets to sing too.
I think every record he starts to get a little more, you know, his octaves go up and his bottoms go lower, you know what I mean? It's cool. There's nothing there, girl, yeah, I swear.
And the album's called Nine Lives. We have a graphic of the album artwork.
You know, art shouldn't be overanalyzed. Art should just be appreciated. But you know, I have to ask you.
Penises.
This is a bald cat.
A bald female cat.
The shaved kitty. We've just been trying to do that for years and get away with it. Come on now. You care to comment?
No, not at all. Falling in love is so hard on the knee. Once again. The Shakespeare of salaciousness, I've heard.
Soliloquy.
I've heard. Great lyrics once again. A lot of favorites that I have. In Falling in Love, My Old Libido Has Blowing a Transistor. My old libido has been blowing a transistor. What's your favorite lyric from the record?
You ain't that good as what you said down to the letter, but you like the way I hold the microphone. Sometimes I'm good, but when I'm bad, I'm even better. Don't give me no lip, I got enough of my own. Sometimes I'm good, but when I'm bad, I'm even better. Don't give me no lip, I got enough of my own. The band, you know, and what we do together as a whole, but there was a time as, how should I say, my scrotal tissue was being pulled from north, south, and east and west, you know, and I thought, you know, this is not what I'm in a band for. I mean, there were some people that we were very close to that were pulling some shots and doing some things that were just not kosher, you know, not had nothing to do with the Aerosmith dream. I could just tell you now that, you know, what Aerosmith is together as a band came close to breaking up this last time when I stopped and thought for 1 minute, what was the most important thing? What was the lesson to get out of this? It was that there's always this agita outside of Aerosmith that seems to be trying to break it up or trying to get into that energy that we have that no one can take away from us. And once we realized that we could own that, and it could be our own, we could polish it up and make it as good or as bad as we want to, as long as we're in charge, it'll always be golden.
If you've ever had, like, the number one single, do you get pissed off at the charts?
Well, you know, when I look at some of the songs that do make it into the top 10, and then, you know, like actually in the top 5, it makes me go, wow, God, I mean, I'm not going to mention any names, but, you know, I don't want to belong to that club if it would have me as a member. I just want to hold you close. I feel your heart so close to mine. And just stay here in this moment for all the rest of time.
First number one in 25 years for Aerosmith?
I think it's the first number one, period. Yeah.
Well, so does that make this way more special to you?
It's weird, you know? I always thought I'd just explode or something when somebody told me I had a number one song, but it's like, okay. Yeah,
Aerosmith on The Simpsons? No way.
Way.
Yeah.
That's it.
Hello, St. Louis!
That's Springfield, Stephen.
Yeah, right. Oh, Aerosmith on The Simpsons? No way!
Way. Way.
Oh, man, you gotta go way! Are you ready to rock? Yeah! I said, are you ready to rock? Yeah! Get it!
Bowl. On paper, to me, I don't think it would have worked, mm-hmm. The theory, mm-hmm. But man, you made me eat my words.
You know, we've always been a one in ten, like, band, you know, Train Kept a Rolling, Dream On, Young Lust, Jane, You Got a Gun, you know, it's always been those opposites. Career, downfall with drugs. Marriage, bring it back up again. Not that any of those have anything to do with each other, but we've always been that, from one gross end to the other. And making it work somewhere in the middle. So when you hear about Britney Spears and Aerosmith and NSYNC and Mary J. and Nelly, it was such a culmination of what? That it was just perfect for us.
I remember thinking, you know, what's next? The Super Bowl. I mean, what's the most ridiculous thing we can think of that we haven't done yet? Play the Super Bowl. Okay.
Lounge act on the shuttle. I'm thinking lounge act on the shuttle.
And the shuttle has cleared the tower.
At best, it was a roll of the dice. I mean, just the technical aspect of setting a stage up, a rock and roll stage in 6 minutes, and having the lighting be right and the sound and all that, it was all worth it. We just thought it was worth taking the shot because the upside was so great.
You know, when we got together and started doing this, there's no way people who are into football wanted us and our kind of music having anything to do with them. It was completely opposite. This whole thing of mixing football and Aerosmith is pretty new for us. So when they call up and they ask us to do it, it's like, wow, we're getting invited to a party that, you know, we never would have gotten invited to before. So we gotta, like, check this out.
Any excuse to get Brittany standing next to you.
That's right.
Planning one on you. Yeah. The whole thing was orchestrated so Brittany can kiss Steven, I'm thinking.
It's funny because the picture that they use on the cover of a lot of papers in America was taken from the rehearsal Friday night as Justin was storming off because his mic wasn't on.
No, because Brittany's kissing you. That's why he's storming off.
Yeah.
Speak of Hendrix and Zeppelin and the Stones and the Beatles with a sense of reverency. You're that to a lot of people.
Yeah, but never in our eyes. We'll never get to that point.
It's not something I can ever relate to. Yeah, I mean, I understand it, I hear it, and sometimes if I think about it, I know we've been around long enough, and I look at the records and the discography and all that, but, you know, those guys were...
The founding fathers.
Those were mentors for me and where my inspiration came from and what helped me to decide that I wanted to do what I'm doing today. And it's important to, for me, it's important to keep them where they are, you know. It's not a comparison or even a relative thing for me.
Because we're all here, because we're not all there.
That's
and
right.
Never will be. Yeah, we're all here, because we're not
all there. That's right. It's a fact of life. I mean, you stick around long enough and make enough noise, I mean, people are going to, I mean, we appreciate that, but we're pretty,
Jaded?
No, I don't think so. I think that we still, you know, because we still listen to those records and remember those concerts and are still inspired by them. I know I am.
Can you define what an Aerosmith song even is?
You know, isn't that the beauty?
If we could write it down and put it in that kind of language, what's the point of doing it?
Once you get the thrill of it, I think, and you taste the blood of the rock and roll, of the, you feel the warmth from the fire that we dance around, it's just insane.
Asking, I think, fans to go on a little bit of a ride with you for this record. Some of the songs didn't sound like Aerosmith.
More than ever, this record sounds like Aerosmith because there's nothing between the idea of the songs and the final piece of music that you're listening to. There wasn't like a producer to get it filtered by, to go in and make another album by the numbers and, you know, well, you guys should sound like this because that's what Aerosmith's supposed to sound like. It's a sampling of all the tastes of things that we've liked over the last few years. So some of those things might even be a little un-Aerosmith sounding. But to us, it every bit of what's on the record feels like Aerosmith to me.
Can you define what an Aerosmith song even is?
No, isn't that the beauty?
That's why we do the music. Because if we could write it down and put it in that kind of language, what's the point of doing it? I mean, it's music is like, it's another form to itself, you know, and it's got to speak for itself.
I'm the one that jaded you. I think that the hunger, the consistency of the hunger is about no matter what we do, or no matter how good we think we're doing it or anybody else thinks we're doing it, there's always a hunger there to do it a little better. And from album to album, I like to think that that's how it gets. But, you know, we're always tweaking and fine-tuning and trying to make our best a little bit better. And that just never seems to go away.
It has to be good. There's no other way to do it. So, yeah, that hunger is still there. Is that, you know, we don't want to f*** up in front of them.
The longevity issue. You've seen so many bands come and go throughout the years. People, I think, like to dwell on it. Mm. I think you've surprised a few people over the years.
All we know is that it's an adventure, and we're doing it every day, and it's, I don't know. We're waiting to see what happens. If somebody asked me yesterday, is it better to fade away or burn out? And I don't know if either of those things work for us. You know, because as long as we find it exciting, we're going to get up and keep doing this. And what else would make us want to sit here and be interviewed?
When you get into your teenage years, you start to realize there's some pretty powerful things that really feel good. And I don't know why those things that felt good then wouldn't feel good now. But I think that's what a good song is about. Mm. It's not, you know, what's in your head and what, you know, the thinking about it. It's feeling it, you know. It's a thing that just feels good to listen to. So it's no different now.
Blues gave birth to a baby named Rock and Roll.
Mm-hmm.
Rock and roll gave birth to a baby named
Joe Perry.
Joe Perry.
We did our own take on it. It's not blues songs like you would think.
We turned our amps up so loud that we could never really call it a blues album. It's a rock record.
In the end, I think you just get the feeling that it's just going to sound like an Aerosmith rock record with a couple of blues songs thrown in.
I'd leave out Bobo and call it Honkin' On.
It's actually Honkin' On Bobo. We just know that it's a phrase that sounds jazzish, nastyish, so it works for us.
It's Honkin' On Bobo. It's not just the blues. It's kind of a roots record for us.
Well, the problem is when you say blues, then you kind of, it stereotypes it into that kind of thing where it sounds like old man's music, but it's, again, it's not. It's a exciting experience is what this record is, and that's what blues should be.
I feel like we're trying to second guess the critics because you put out a blues album and it's not blues enough for them. You put out a rock album. What we did was we put out songs that we loved and we did them Aerosmith style and redid them in the studio as Joe would sing, you know, Stop Messing at Any Great Night. And we did redid it live in the studio with all of us playing at once, and it just, it had a vibe and a sound, and we really caught it.
We didn't know what it was going to come out sounding like, you know, and now at this end of it, when we have this piece of work in our hands that we all of a sudden are like, wow, this is really great. And I mean, because we like it, you know, and so we want people to give it a chance and not stereotype the record and thinking it's a blues record and just a blues record and just dismissing it as that.
We're doing some blues songs that go way back into the history. I mean, they were recorded a really long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll go and really concentrate on trying to get the feel of just the way they played it, you know, these guys that have been playing it every night in clubs all over the Delta. And we get that, but then it somehow turns into, you know, the Aerosmith version of it. And it's got just, you know, I don't know, the amps are loud or something. But it's...
Well, a little funk to
blues
it.
Blues has this, right?
Yeah.
And the rock and roll just brings it up a notch.
Record because it was pretty experimental. His spirit came out and he evoked, you know, the spirits of, I think, the grandfathers of the great blues players. He's got something in there that's somewhere else. I don't know where, but it came out on the record.
Still exciting after all this time?
It feels good, you know?
But sometimes things that you really love, things that you really dig, that really get under your skin, after a while, it just doesn't have that same magic that it used to.
Sometimes.
Can you read that?
Nice.
There it is.
Nice.
And it depends on what you're crazed out on, you know? Do the skateboarders ever put it down, sell their wheels? You know what I mean? It's like, once you get the thrill of it, I think, and you taste the blood of the rock and roll, of the, you feel the warmth from the fire that we dance around. It's just insane.
When Steven talks, I love it.
But I love your questions, man. This guy, do you see Bill? This is not Kill Bill. This is not Don't Mess With Bill. This is not Does He Fit The Bill? This is Wild Bill.